So good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. If you're on Facebook, hello. I am Cecile from Propel Youth Arts WA. I'm the project manager at Propel. I'm just the welcoming committee for this afternoon, so I'll disappear in 2 secs. But I just wanted to start this off with a acknowledgement to country. So I want to acknowledge the Whadjuk people of the Noongar Nation as the traditional custodians of the land that myself and the majority of us here live upon. However, most of our panelists and some of our non-WA guests are not currently on Noongar land. So I also want to acknowledge the First Nations people of your land too. This week is Reconciliation Week in Australia. So it's a week especially where we're asked to acknowledge and reflect upon the traditional lands and culture of the First Nations people and pay respect to their elders past and present. So this video is currently being recorded. So Propel will upload the recorded version on our website and to our YouTube a little bit later. So if you're streaming in live at the moment and you have to leave early, you can catch the rest of it at a later time. But yes, welcome to all our lovely panelists here. We've got Michelle Hunder, Demas Rusli, Craig Hello. Parry, and Jarrad Seng with us. All absolutely amazing photographers based in Australia, I'm assuming most of you guys are. And hello to everybody if you're from Perth, if you're from the East Coast. We've got a few international friends as well. So thank you so much for joining us today. Jarrad, I'll pass this over to you.
Thank you very much. Cool. Well, thanks everybody. Thanks for coming in and checking this out. I think it's going to be a great session with these amazing photographers. We're all based in Australia. We all travel a lot for our jobs. I think we've got 4 different states here. I'm in WA, Michelle's in Victoria, Craig's in Queensland. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
New South Wales.
Yeah, it's a truly national broadcast. So everyone, welcome. Thank you to Propel for extending the invite to run this session. I used to work for Propel. Propel was actually my job before I became a photographer. So I have a lot of love for Propel. And what Propel does is provide opportunities and encouragement for young artists in WA, and they help facilitate a lot of cool stuff. So yeah, I think this will be a really unique session. Hope you get a lot out of it. What we're going to do is break down some of the panel's favorite images, because I think that's the best way to learn. You know, when you find out how something is made, it actually doesn't seem that hard after all. And then it's a lot easier to be inspired. And because sometimes, I mean, I'm sure everybody feels this, when you scroll through Instagram, you scroll through the internet, and you see all these crazy photos that everybody's doing, it can be pretty intimidating. Even I feel that as well. And I start thinking, I suck. Look at all these amazing things that I can't do. But when you sit down and work out, you know, how it's actually done, it doesn't actually seem that hard. Cool. So I'm just going to quickly introduce the other three with me. We have Michelle, who is in Melbourne right now. And Michelle's an amazing music photographer and portrait photographer. She's probably one of the most well-known music photographers in Australia, I would say. She's doing amazing work. We have Craig, who is an underwater photographer, as you can see in the slide there. He gets up to some pretty amazing things that not a lot of people get to see. And Demas, we have in Sydney, who is a travel photographer, a Photoshop master. He does things that I have no idea how they're done. But the thing is, the cool thing about Demas is he still works as an architect as well. So like many hats for you. Quick question.
Funny thing, I just quit. Okay.
Oh. All right, let me just delete some work.
I just quit this morning.
Crazy. I sent my
email, resignation email this morning.
Okay, well, yeah. I can't wait to talk about that. Quick question for everyone. Can you hear an echo with my voice?
No.
Good. I can. It's really annoying, but if you can't hear it, it's fine. It's okay. Well, let's get straight. by the way, this is the power of photography, everyone. Just look at our pictures here on the slide and compare it to our real life versions of ourselves. That's what good photography does and why it's worth learning.
I do my hands. It's nearly the same.
All right, I'm going to apologize in advance for any technical difficulties. I've got my iPad set up with a presentation. I think it'll work, but it might not. But first, I'm going to jump straight into one of Michelle's photos that she's provided. She tells me it's one of her most favorite photos she's ever taken. Let's see it.
Yay.
Pretty awesome. So while everybody is reveling in the greatness of this photo, I just want to quickly chat with you, Michelle. So why don't you tell everybody what you do?
Yeah, cool. So I'm a professional music photographer. So I guess my main, bread and butter comes from like press shots and album covers that I do for artists. And then the other thing that I get to do is tour the world, doing live music photography as well. So it's a really amazing life, and I've been doing it for 10 years now. I feel very fortunate, actually. I feel like it's the best job in the world. It doesn't really ever feel like work. I get to work with, I've worked with some of my favorite artists in the whole world, and I've been lucky enough to, been paid to go on tour and take photographs. So it's a pretty good job. Yeah.
And something that you're very passionate about is championing younger photographers, and especially female younger photographers, because I guess the photography industry and music photography is generally, you don't see a lot of young female photographers in that space. Why is that, and what are you doing to try and change that?
Why is a really good question. I'm actually not entirely sure. Potentially just didn't know, or didn't even think of it as an option, or see other people doing it. Like, I think that's a real big thing for young women, is being able to see what's possible and being able to achieve that. So I guess, I think through my visibility and people actually seeing me on stage with artists that they love, like, I just get hit up all of the time. And a lot of it is from young women. And I've just become really, really passionate about mentoring young girls and women. You know, they can do this as a job. And to be honest, like, in the last probably 5 years, it really, really has drastically changed. It's like, I remember when I first started shooting, I would never see another woman in the pit ever. Like, it just was so rare. And now it's like, it's really, really common to see, maybe up to 4 or 5 women, at a gig or something. So, and it's really great. And I believe that the best music photographers in Australia at the moment are women as well. I feel like there's a real sensibility and intuitiveness, I think, that comes with being a woman and shooting music as well. There's something about it that I really like, and I like to see that in other women's work as well. So I'm really, really passionate about trying to inspire other young girls to pursue this as a career. Yeah.
Amazing. Let's get onto this photo. Tell me what's happening here and why do you love this shot?
Yeah, so this is actually the last show of the European leg of the world tour. So it was actually the third last show of the entire world tour, and the last one of the, we did 2 extra shows in Bangkok after this, but this is the last show of the European leg. We'd already done all of Australia, all of America, and then Europe, and this shot was in Amsterdam. And obviously you can see it's a sold out crowd, and the energy that night was, I think, particularly hype, because I think everybody knew that it was the last show of the European leg. So there's really, really good vibes. The energy already was amazing, and this particular shot, so the artist that I'm touring with is Rule. That's what I do. The artist that I tour with is Rule. If you don't know who he is, he's a really young, he's 17-year-old, incredible singer that I've been working with since he was 13 years old. So I've been doing all of his press shots, album covers, and touring shows, I guess, since he started touring when he was 15. 14 and a bit. So obviously I work really closely with Rule, and you really start to know and understand an artist after you've been working with them for this long. And this particular shot was, he had just started doing a jump from the drum riser, and he started doing it really at like the end of the tour. So maybe the last couple of shows. And I had got the shot from the front a few times, but I'd never got this particular angle. And I just think that it's the perfect venue. I just love how there's like, I guess, multi-levels, because I don't think it would have had as much impact if it had everybody had been on one level. Like, you get that perspective of having people on that second level as well. And obviously just the timing got it really right for this particular shot. It's not a easy shot to get, and you do have to kind of rapid fire, and I had one before and one after, I think, but this was the one that was like framed perfectly. I don't know, people like look at this and are wondering how he's contorted his body like that, because when you see it from the front, it doesn't look like, I don't know, it's weird that his legs all the way back and twisted, but it didn't look like that in real time. But for some reason that moment in time, that's where his foot was. So it looks pretty crazy.
I think for a photo like this, you know, someone might look at it and think, okay, this is all about being in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
Which sounds easy enough, but actually to even get to the point where you can be in the right place in the right time, that's actually the hard bit. So maybe talk about like what it takes to actually have the access to be able to be crouching down behind an artist like at a sold out show.
Yeah, that's a good point, because I guess a lot of the show photographs that you see of artists from most music photographers would be from the front. So potentially music photographers would be working for a publication, and they would go and they would just shoot the first three songs, and then they would either be escorted from the building, or they might get to stay and watch the gig, but they wouldn't be allowed to shoot. So what I've been able to do over the last, pretty much since I guess started working in music photography, is I went a little bit of a different route, and I started working with artists direct rather than working for publications. I was really passionate about having relationships with artists and working directly with them, which means that if they, you know, do take you on tour, you have completely different access. Like, you have, you know, it's called AAA. You can go wherever you like. Not to mention that I've been working with Rule for so long now, it's like we almost have like, it's like mental telepathy. Like, we know where each other is. I know what he's going to do. He knows where I am, even without looking at me. It's a really weird thing we can't really describe. But that's definitely happened just because of years working together. So, and also knowing the show intimately, this is probably the 50th show that I've shot at this point. And like I said, he had started to do this jump a few shows before. So I knew the moment of the song. I knew where I needed to be to get this. I just had to obviously navigate running from wherever I was in the venue to get behind and hopefully the videographer's not in my way, because he also has a habit of doing that sometimes. So I'll elbow him out of the way. No, we're really close as well. So we work together and make sure we're able to get the shot. So
So we're talking about like working directly with an artist. So I think this is something that like so many young photographers would love to be doing, you know, touring around with an artist. And I'm sure a lot of the questions you get are, you know, where do I even begin?
Yeah,
you know, to get to this stage. Can you share some advice on just some brief advice on the you know, what people can do to start off with, and what they should be doing, what they shouldn't be doing.
So yeah, I think, I mean, everyone always sees, you know, shots like this and like, oh my God, I'd love to tour with Rule, but obviously it, you know, that's like 10 years in the making. Like, I didn't start doing that. I started working with really local small bands and groups and people that, you know, might not even be getting radio play at that point, but they were playing small shows, and just, I guess, making myself known and being part of the music industry. Like, I really made myself part of the industry and the scene that I was originally shooting predominantly hip hop. So I was just going to every show just rocking up with the camera and, you know, shooting a lot of shows for free when I first started as well. Like I said before, a lot of people want to be shooting the big shows and they go down the route of shooting for publications. Most publications in Australia don't pay, so they end up in this weird cycle of just working for free forever. So I've been trying to, I guess, mentor people in the space of trying to establish relationships, but, you know, grassroots level, like just go in and if your friend's in a band, go take photos for them and work your way up that way. It's just about knowing lots of people, taking lots of photos, people starting to know you for your work. You know, there's no shortcuts really. It's just lots and lots of years of hard work, really.
Yeah, I think that's the same story across the board for all successful music photographers. You know, yeah. A lot of messages I get are probably the same as yours, where I might be at an Ed Sheeran show or a Passenger show and people message me saying, I just got a new camera.
Yeah.
Can I come and take photos of Ed Sheeran?
Yeah. It doesn't work like that, really.
No, it doesn't work like that. You know, you don't just jump up there. You know, you have to prove yourself. And you can't just jump to this level. And the reason like that level is so high is because so many people want to do that one thing, you know, and there's only limited people that can, you know, so you have to work your way up and start at first shoot things that not everybody wants to
do. Yeah, totally.
And that's local shows. And
literally going to, you know, shows with maybe 50 people at tiny venues with very, very bad lighting. But all of that practice, like you need that practice in those venues because when you start working with artists, like for example, Rule plays really big shows in Australia now. He might play to 5,000 people in Australia, but when we go to Europe or go to America, the venues are a little bit smaller and might not have perfect lighting. So you need to rely on those skills that you got when you were shooting small venues to be able to get shots that match the shows that have, you know, full lighting rig and a lighting person and all that sort of stuff. So,
and also have trust and have faith in these artists when they aren't famous. You know, it's easy totally. Enough to latch onto someone when they're already famous.
Absolutely. Like, yeah, like I said,
and me shooting Passenger, you know, I started working with Passenger when he was just busking on the street.
Yeah. So, well, the first gig I shot for Rule was at a venue in Melbourne that was just an outdoor bar with like 20 people and he just got up and did a little song. And like, I've literally been working with him from the very start, and he, you know, he did support shows for a long time as well. Mm. So
like, I think the loyalty is rewarded, you know, in these kind of industries.
Absolutely.
You talk about Ed Sheeran's crew, for example, his entire like inner circle crew are just his mates from school.
Like, yeah, it's very, very common.
Photographers and videographers.
Yeah. I know Sean, chef. Sean Mendes is the same. He's had the exact same tour people for 5 years now. His photographer's been with him since he was 15. Like, it's a really, really common story. Mm. I think especially with artists that become really, really popular, they want a crew that they can trust and their best friends, you know.
Mm. All right, we better move on. I think I already took up too much time on your photo. Actually, next slide I think is a 30-second video
of the shot
shows I think the context, got, which
yeah.
I think it's nice to watch. It puts everyone in the mood and
you can see the moment.
Yeah, you can see like what it's actually.
Getting emotional.
So you can see the exact moment that happens, and I think that's the power of photography. Video is great because you can capture movement and all this, but you know, that was a split second in that video.
Yeah,
so is totally. That one photo you've got,
it doesn't look like he jumped as high as it looks, I think, in the still as well. Like, it just, yeah, it's weird. But
all right, I'm gonna move forward. I can't remember who's next. Actually, it's Demas.
Oh, it's me. Hello.
How are you going, mate? Let's okay, crazy image. Lots of breakdown here. tell us like what the inspiration was behind creating this and how you went about doing it. We actually have a video to play with it, which is you a speed warp if you editing it through. I'll play that in a second.
Okay.
But maybe first talk about your inspiration behind this.
So hello everyone, my name is Demas Rusli. I am a photographer and designer and I'm based in Sydney, Australia. I have been doing photography for about 8 years now and I didn't expect to be a photographer. Like I wanted to be an architect growing up, like I was saying before. I worked in architecture, so I did uni in architecture. I worked for 5 years in an architecture firm and I literally resigned this morning. Throughout university, I picked up a camera and just started love shooting, like mostly architecture and cities and travel and urban stuff. But because of architecture and going through university and doing lots of Photoshop, I learned a lot of like Photoshop techniques and skills that I tried to implement into my photography as well. And so I try to play around with like just messing with people's heads with like photography and like, this image here is like a day and a night mix and it's two different cities. It's like the left side is Taiwan and the right side is New York. And there's a spot in Taiwan where a plane goes through, like there's actually a spot in Taiwan where you can go high enough where you can see a plane passing through the city. And then I thought it'd be cool to try to Photoshop in, because I didn't have a night version of the Taiwan one. To Photoshop in a night version of a different city, which I had from New York, which I shot from a helicopter. I had this idea. I've been doing sort of like these sort of edits, like day and night edits for a while. So it's sort of like just a continuation of a personal project that I've been working on, just for myself to test out, you know, if I can do it in Photoshop or not. And it turned out to work fine and it looked cool in my opinion. I'm very proud of it.
I think in everyone's opinion, yeah. it looks pretty cool. So many layers to that. Two different cities, shooting from a helicopter. I'm just going to put the video so we can talk over it because it's just like a speed edit, I think.
So I captioned it like flying through time zones, like different time zones. It feels like you're, you know, on that split between like day and night when you're traveling. But yeah, the whole editing process is just like going through Lightroom, color grading both images, and then just kind of just a trial and error of messing around like how the split would work in Photoshop. And then after that, you work out the details of like lighting up the plane's windows and like just little things here and there and just trying to get the details right to make it look super realistic.
So what are you doing right now or what you're seeing on screen?
So the first image I edited was a New York one, which is this... just the right side of it. So now I'm just straightening it, bringing it into Photoshop. And this is the other image of the Taiwan shot. And so I'm just editing both in Lightroom first, and then I bring it both into Photoshop and try to combine it somehow.
At what point do you get the inspiration for that? Or do you realize that the final image is what you're going for? Did you already know that when you took the first image?
So for this one, I knew that, like as in I was looking through like old photos and stuff, and then because we've all been at home quarantining, so I've just been like re-editing old photos and trying to get like new concepts with old photos. So I've found both images and I'm like, maybe this could work. Maybe I could try to bring it together and try to come up with this concept. Because usually what I've done in the past is only just like the same shot day and night. I just stay like for a couple of hours and wait, get a day shot, get a night shot. But this case, I just wanted to try something different and see if I could bring two different cities together.
What's going on here in this? You seem to be cloning out the building and why are you making all these adjustments to the building?
So I got rid of the plane just to see what it might look like without the plane and just to like, I'm going to bring the plane back in later, but I just wanted to get the background right first. Mm-hmm. So this is me. That's already the split like happening there. And then me adjusting to see how it would work out in the end, or like if the perspective would even work or not. And then when I did that split and I started like just gradually masking out bit by bit, it kind of looked fine. Like, and I'm like, this is going to turn out pretty cool. So
up until now, it actually seems fairly easy to follow along. I think for anyone, even if someone, you know, isn't into photography so much, you can probably understand what's happening, you know, two different images.
Yep.
One's split, a day, half, one's half, at night. You're just
trying to get like the gradient to not look as like split, like dead, you know, a straight line. You want it to be like a gradual fade. But then, yeah, just like positioning it in the right place and like making sure that, like, you know, nothing looks weird on that. You just zoom in like really hard and just try to see if anything's going to look weird.
How do you learn how to do this? Did you study? Is this through your like architecture studies or?
Yeah. So I taught myself how to use Photoshop during university because we had to. Like, if you didn't know how to use Photoshop and you didn't have like a good presentation at the end of the semester, and you know, you wouldn't do as well at university. So we all have to teach ourselves Photoshop. And like, I find that like in architecture, it's, in architecture, I feel
definitely
like
spam email that one.
The photoshopping in architecture is much more like, you got to do so much more than in photography, because in architecture you're kind of creating things from scratch, and it's like a line drawing, and you have to put textures on it, you have to put all the lighting on it yourself, you have to, you know, get all the shadows right. But in photography, you kind of already have a start, like you start somewhere and you just have to take it somewhere else. So I always say like photography is a little bit like cheating, because like in architecture you start from scratch, but you already have a start in photography. So this is me playing around with the plane. I mastered out and trying to see the position of where it might look nice on the image. So I'm just moving it around, trying to like position it. I decided to go up a little bit higher. Just moving it around.
I have a question from Ria that was sent in the registrations.
Yeah.
I guess it was to all of us, but I think it'd be great to ask you, how did this passion for photography, how did it change your life? And obviously you've had some major life changes due to this passion.
Definitely a big change in my life, because like I picked up my first camera in like second year of university, and I at the same time posted on Instagram, and I just kept posting on Instagram, and it just grew over time. And suddenly like I get reached out by clients, and I'm starting doing some work, earning some money. And it's like, this is so cool. Like, I didn't ever imagine to earn money from photography. And now I'm doing it full time starting today.
What was the kicker? Because I only talked to you maybe 3 weeks ago, and you still, and we were talking about how you balance your day job with photography. What gave you the push?
So the last 2 months, so the last year I've been part-time in the architecture firm, and because of all this coronavirus stuff, because I'm part-time, they've asked me to take like leave, and also leave after I finish all my annual leave. They told me to take leave without pay. And I was like, okay, well, let's just try it out. So the last 2 months I've been on leave. So I just use that as a test to be like, can I do this as a photographer? Can I just go full time? And turns out I can. So I just decided to just call it. I feel like I could have done it like long time ago, but I just thought like, you know, this is the perfect time to do it.
Amazing. I'm not sure how much longer is left in this video. I think we might have to speed through. Yeah,
but anyways, it's just like, this is the detail part where I was saying before how like I started lighting up the windows of the plane in the background, just to make it seem like it's coming from night to day, and just make it more believable. Like when you're editing stuff like this, because it's so like surreal, you have to really think about like the lighting, the details, and get that right. I think
that's what makes your images so great, because like you do focus on these tiny little 1% details that a lot of people would think, oh, it's not worth my time just to fix a little window. But when you start doing this across all your work, you just, all these little percentages add up.
And yeah, I think so.
What's great about your photography is people do question it. You look at it and it takes them a while to work out whether it's real or not.
Yeah. Yeah, well, most of the time it's real. Sometimes it's not, but like it's funny, because like I just never, like if it's obviously Photoshop like this, then people will obviously know. But there's times where like I Photoshopped like maybe people have seen the plane in a forest shot that, yeah, it's like I Photoshopped the top down photo of a plane, in a forest, and people keep asking me where that forest is, but it doesn't exist. I just have like, it's just a bit of fun for me, and I just like, I enjoy it. So that's why I keep doing it.
I think it's a cool example of taking, you know, photography and then putting a creative spin on it, like enhancing it, through another means. And that's something I'm going to talk about later, actually, with collaborations. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to click off this video. We're pretty much at the end now anyway. I think there can't be too much more we're doing to this. Okay, yeah. I'm going to go through because I want to get to Craig's amazing work here. So Craig, we met when I think we were on assignment in New Zealand. I feel like that's where we met.
Flight Center or something,
Yeah.
Years ago?
Something. I don't know.
was it Kaikoura?
Yes.
That was it.
And I think I was just like amazed that like all your specialized gear you had, like, this was before, you know, a lot of people had drones and you had this like crazy drone and
handmade drone
and all this underwater stuff. How did you start out in underwater photography?
Well, when I was really young, my mum used to buy me those disposable plastic cameras. And so you'd only get 36 photos out of them. So I used to get one for my birthday and Christmas. And so I had to be really careful with the photos I took, because once I rolled that film out, then I had no opportunity to get another one, because for a 7-year-old or whatever, that was $30. So there's a lot of chores around the house to get that up. So yeah, from there I guess the passion sort of grew, and I living on the north coast of New South Wales, surfing was a big part of my life, and the ocean's been a big part of my life as well. So yeah, it sort of just grew from there. And it wasn't probably until my late teens I really started taking it a little bit more serious, you know, when I could actually afford to have a water house, in a proper water house and a proper camera. And then it sort of just manifested from there. And I had a few people at school that inspired me. I never did photography at school, but it was, I look at their work and I used to get really jealous. I was like, I can do that. You know, I was really inspired by them. So it sort of just, you know, as time went on, my passion sort of got stronger and stronger.
Yeah, I think that's, I mean, I wonder if that's how the other guys started too, because it's the same with me. I saw somebody at concerts, one of my friends, he was always there taking photos at the front of the room. And this is back when I was into journalism. So I was at the back of the room with a little notepad, and I just kept thinking, I'm sure I could do what he's doing. Like, it doesn't look that hard.
It's probably the only time jealousy is actually good. drives you in a direction. Yeah.
But when I look at your, but the difference is when I look at like your photos, I don't think I could do that.
Well, I don't know. It's spray and pray, you know.
Tell me about this specific moment. I think I just saw it pop up in chat. Someone was asking if there was a shark down the bottom.
No, that's another whale down there. So there's actually three whales in this image. So there's one on the bottom right. And if you look to the bottom of the whale with its pec, you'll see another fin down there as well. So this particular photo was taken in 2014. And it was, and the reason I chose it for today's podcast is it was probably the most defining moment in my career as a photographer, and also just as a human being. You know, I always had a tendency to really get drawn towards nature, but this was the second time of my life that I'd ever swam with a humpback whale, and this particular whale was a female, and she was unusually curious towards me. So I was actually swimming with these three whales for 2 hours, and I thought this was normal. Like, you know, this is my second time in the water. I'm like, hang on, this is pretty good. And the captain's like, Craig, I've not seen an interaction like that in 10 years. So it sort of it set the precedent pretty high for the rest of the trip, you know. So yeah, this particular image, it's sort of because I had so much time to swim with the whale that I developed this kind of a weird bond with it. And you see this image here, and this is actually me swimming back towards the boat, checking the actual photo that you had just seen. So, and I'm swimming back to the boat, looking at the back of my water housing for the photo. And this whale that I've just taken a photo of comes up behind me and starts pushing me with its nose back to the boat.
Wow. Just wants to make sure, approve the shot.
Yeah, he wants to have a look as well.
But this is a good meme for like the client looking over your shoulder.
That's it. Is it good enough? Well, you get on the side. So then when I got back to the boat, this particular whale would sit beside the boat waiting for me to jump in again. So yeah, and I thought to myself, well, this would be a really good opportunity to, you know, to get a, like back then in 2014, selfies weren't really a thing. And I just wanted to show everyone, you know, put it in purpose, you know, and in perspective and show people what I was experiencing. And you can see from this photo, because I'm swimming away from the whales, they're actually chasing me. So yeah, it was a really strange moment. And it was, for me, it really developed that connection and addiction that I've got now for the underwater world.
That's crazy. So to any like young photographer who's looking at this and yeah. thinking, you know, I want to get there someday, you know, what, yeah. how hard is it to just to start?
Well, my career has been going for a while. I think back in 2009, that was a part of my career where I sort of made the decision to become a professional photographer. But before then, you know, I was working on weddings and I was doing wedding photography and portraits and all those odd things just to make a little bit of money to pay for my cameras. And I think that's really important to simplify is to actually try and learn how light works, you know, and by doing those jobs like, you know, portraiture, even if it's not a passion, I still really enjoyed it, but it wasn't that burning desire that I had that I have for underwater photography, but it still put me in the right direction and showed me how light worked and how my camera worked and how to work really quickly with my camera. Because a good thing that I, you know, a lot of my students, because I do teach a lot of people photography, and one thing I tell my students is that really try and practice shooting your camera in manual. It's really important. You know, it's like when Michelle was, you know, looking at her imagery as well, you know, you've got dark parts of the photo and you got a lot of light. And sometimes if you're shooting on an auto function, the camera can get a little bit confused, and you don't want to really, as you become a professional, you don't want to take those risks of almost getting the shot. You have to get the shot. And to do that, manual settings are really important. Yeah. Mm. I think that's my biggest thing. I think, and don't try and rush the process of trying to become successful and trying to become that next Instagram sensation or that next National Geographic photographer. I think you've got to, the best part of the journey, the best part of it's that actual journey of becoming, you know, that, and it's not, it's not strong enough that you want to be it. You've got to have that like ache in your stomach. And it's not, you don't, you can't think, you know, being successful is not because you want to be famous or you want to earn money from it. It's not about that. It's that, it's this weird feeling that you get in your gut, you know?
Mm. Yeah, I think that's super important. I think, you know, it's important to distinguish like early on that, you know, the goal shouldn't be to get that crazy photo. The goal should be create a lifestyle for yourself where you are in these situations to take these photos, yeah. you know? It,
that's
it's
right.
Not the end result, you know, it's not like publishing a book is becoming a person who's a writer. You know, it's all about the process.
That's it. And it's a ratio of persistence and effort and so that's where I look at getting images that I've won awards for. It's about the persistence of it. And then people go, oh, you know, you're so lucky you got that photo of that animal. You know, it's really unusual you got that image of that animal. And I said, well, yeah, it is lucky, but it's all a ratio of persistence and hard work and opportunity. And opportunity comes from hard work. So, yeah, I mean, I've done a lot in my career. You know, I've worked with in music festivals as well, which has been really rewarding. I worked on the Blues Fest, and that was fantastic. And you meet a lot of great people on the way. And who knows, like in I've just started working with National Geographic on a new documentary, and this documentary is not about animals; it's about the human being. So it's kind of all those skills I learnt back when I was younger shooting weddings and portraiture are coming back into play now, and it's great to have those skills, you know, skill set there for me to call upon. Mm.
Awesome! I like what you said about luck, because some things do seem lucky. But they're not.
Yeah. No.
You're not. You're lucky if you buy one lotto ticket and you that's luck. Right. It's not luck if you bought a million lotto tickets and then you won. Create the opportunities. Yeah. Okay.
That's it.
Next image. What have we got? Ah, one of mine. Okay. Whoops. All right. Yeah, that's not the final image. I started with the behind the scenes. So I chose this image because a few people have asked about this image in particular. It's of my friend, Bella Kotak, who's an amazing photographer as well. I needed to create an image for Perth Fashion Festival, and it was to be displayed in the window of a restaurant called The Flower Factory. They asked me to do this. The problem was I was traveling at the time on tour, and I said, I think I could squeeze this in somehow, somewhere. So I found myself in London, and I thought, okay, I've got a spare day. Maybe I'll try and get this flower photo. And there was no brief other than, you know, try and make it something to do with flower. So we went, got a bunch of flower. I messaged my friends as Bella Kotak. Natasha is on the right there. She's another photographer. Don't know, some of this young audience might know who Lewis Watson is. He's a acoustic folk singer in UK. Very good. Very good tours with, you know, he's toured with Ed Sheeran and One Direction and all those guys. Anyway, he was in town as well. So I said, do you want to come and throw some flour on my friend? So I started with this because it shows how ridiculous, you know, some of these, how some of these photos are taken. Basically, you know, we had a dress and I just wanted all this, like, you know, flower and dust looking things flying around in the air. Bella didn't mention this entire time, but she's actually gluten intolerant. So we were, you know, potentially causing some harm. She just didn't say anything. And then I went through my Photoshop file and I wanted to show you the stages of, you know, what it takes to get to the final image. Oh, there's a bit of lag on this, but okay. So as you can see, it started off, that's the actual, you know, dress we had. And I'm pretty sure like a bit of fabric as well. It's not actually a dress. And then, you know, it just wasn't grand enough. So I'm in Photoshop. I took a little bit of the dress from one of the other takes, added it on a little bit more. Okay, I've kind of jumped a few steps here to the final image. But I just wanted to demonstrate that, you know, with Photoshop and like Demas has shown, you know, you can really enhance images if you want to, if that's the purpose of it. You know, obviously it's not for everything. If you're shooting for tourism, you can't just change the sky to a magic sunset when it wasn't there. Yeah. But for something like this, we wanted this fairy tale vibe. We just shot as much as we could with the time that we had. And then combined all the elements together to make this. And I wanted to also talk about this image because it was a huge, huge practice in collaboration from the very get-go. You know, it was, you know, having inspiration for the idea, looking at my network and seeing who's in the same city I am, who can help out. This kind of photography is actually Bella's forte and not so much mine. So there was actually a lot of sending the Photoshop file back and forth. She was helping me with all these things. So we're in different countries doing this. It needed to go up on display in Perth. And obviously I didn't want to just print it off and put it up. I had to think of a cool way to do it. I thought, you know, maybe I create this timber grid structure to stick it on. Trouble is I'm not in Perth at all this entire time. So I had to, you know, sketch plans on a little notepad in a hotel room, send that to my friend who's good at woodwork, send that to the printer who printed it off, ask a big favor of my other friend who could put it together and hang it up. All this stuff happened while I wasn't even in Perth. And then we finally got to the end result in the shop front here, which is there. So I thought that was a really cool way of like making things happen. And just being resourceful and finding ways to make things happen. You know, originally I might have thought when they asked me to do this, I thought, no, that's a bit too hard. You know, I'm not even in Perth. How am I going to do it? But I thought about it and I thought, you know what? I do have a lot of people in my network that would love to help because I've helped them before. That's a lesson in doing favors to other people because I want to help you in return later on. This, you know, this could have easily said no to this, but I said yes. And then we come out with this cool piece of art. All right, moving on to next image. Back to Michelle. I have a bit of an interview with Julia to play.
Do you want to play that first or?
No, I reckon we can just talk about it here, you know, because okay. I'd like to know why you chose this photo.
Yeah. I think I chose this particular photo because it was one of those moments where, you know, this is what was one of my biggest shoots to date at the point. This was actually quite a few years ago. So Julia would have been one of the biggest artists that I would have worked with. This was back in 2014. And, you know, you go through the process of planning and doing makeup and having this great location. And what actually happened was this was actually a shoot for a series that I did, which was called Her Sound, Her Story. It was a 88 portrait series. And we also made a documentary on women in music. So it was a collaboration, like you were just talking about, Jarrad, with another friend of mine, Claudia. So what happened on the day when we met Julia, we just all hit it off, like really, really hit it off, and ended up talking and talking and talking and getting along so well that it really ate into the time that we were meant to be shooting. And this was meant to be a sunset shoot. So by the time we actually did her makeup, got down to the location, we literally had 10 minutes to shoot this shot. So it was a shot that's like needed to be in an exhibition. So it's going to be exhibition worthy. And you know, it was just, I guess that what Craig was saying before was learning those lessons, like through things like wedding photography and all of those other, I did wedding photography as well. And they really teach you the skills of getting the shot quickly, working with different light. So all those skills that you get when you're younger really come into fruition when you're put into a situation like this, when you literally have 10 minutes of light and you have to get a shot. And Julia was like running around, which is why I want to show that video, because she was running around and just like, I literally was just following her going, oh my God, where's she going? And then she ran into the water. I just chased her into the water. I literally fell over and almost my camera, I had to like hold my camera up like this because I fell over on a rock. And then anyway, we got this shot, which is really beautiful. So I just thought it was a hilarious story about things not exactly going to plan, but yeah, you know, being able to get something.
And and using the time that you have, you know, like things get done when they get done. Yeah.
Yeah.
It takes as long as it takes, I think is a saying, you know.
Yes.
I want to ask, do you think you would, let's say you had an hour to get this shot. Do you think you would have done something different, or do you think probably would have ended up with something the same anyway?
No, probably. Like, I actually like to work like that. Like, I like to be quite spontaneous and not planned, and it, you know, things that happen like this, you know, are really great. So it doesn't really bother me. I actually think I work better under pressure anyway. So for me personally, no. I know that like that sometimes freaks other photographers out. Like they prefer to be really structured and planned. And but I like that kind of in the moment. Like even this shot, it's not perfect. Like the focus isn't perfect, but there's something in the movement and the feeling of it that I just love. And it was the one that she loved the most as well. So you know, there's something in that sometimes, that those not quite so perfect moments that just make something really great in photography. And I really like that.
I like the idea of the end product of photography being guided by the parameters that you have, mm-hmm. you know, because you only have 10 minutes to shoot, this is what happens. Yeah. And because I think I'm the same. Sometimes I prefer it when there's severe limitations,
yeah. on what
you shoot, because it actually narrows down your field of vision and you just focus. Like, I got 10 minutes, let's run yeah. around, let's get something crazy.
Some of my favorite photos, I think, have come from that. Like,
I think,
you know,
so.
10 minutes, 5 minutes, 2 minutes, something, you know? Yeah.
I reckon you get into a creative flow state. You know, I think nothing else is coming into your mind and you're just focused on that one thing, and it's sort of quite totally. Exciting, you know?
Yeah, it's been very present. It is like a form of meditation and like you said, flow state. Like you just, there's nothing else that is distracting you. It's just like this. Yeah. So it's a very, very cool thing to experience, that's for sure.
And sometimes it's a blessing, you know, say you were given like, you had your makeup ready and then you had 3 hours to shoot.
Yeah.
Then it's like, what do I do now? Three hours, you know, do we have, we have to do all these different things to make sure we fill the time?
And we just got that really beautiful last 10 minutes of light of the day as well, which is, you know, as photographers, you know how perfect that light is. So if we had got there earlier, you would have been like waiting for that moment. You would have lost all that spontaneity. So it kind of did work out perfect, really, I think.
I'm going to play the video. I think it's about 40 seconds just to give some context. And I included a bit of, you know, some of the words that Julie was saying.
Yeah, it's a beautiful interview.
Really quite nice.
this love. Feeling more myself and more authentic to how I want to express myself. I think watching women do that has been an inspiration for sure. They're surviving, they're alive, they're existing, they're successful, they're loved. Why wouldn't people, you know, care about me if I just do whatever I feel like doing right now? We're all in this together. None of us are different. We're all the same, and particularly among the community of women, that connection and that support and that love needs to be cultivated and nurtured more than ever. True expression is so important, because each time somebody does it, somebody else feels like they can do it. I really believe everybody is an artist, you know, and everybody has something to offer the world. And if we all are doing it, then there's just so much joy to be had.
So when she's, you know, waist deep in the water, that means you are as well, right?
Yeah. And wasn't really expecting to be, if that makes sense. So I, as you can see, she was running up and down. I just literally was chasing her. It was like, oh, well, I'm good. Here I go. So yeah, it was quite hilarious. And like I said, I nearly dropped my camera, which is pretty funny. But, you know, got some great shots, which is
all cool. A part of it. There's so many stories that are behind these, you know, single yeah. frames that... Yeah. No, great to hear.
Totally.
All right, coming back to you, Craig. Wasn't sure whether this was the final.
Well, I can share my screen, can't I? And just do a quick little.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
I just wanted to show the process on how I came to this image, and it's very simple, and it's just a fun little exercise. Yeah, there we go. So that's okay.
I'm not sure how to turn mine off, to be honest.
Yeah. If I click on, hang on, if I do this, it'll stop you now. So, no, maybe it won't work. Let me just try this.
Give it a shot.
Yeah. Zoom. Hang on. I've got to allow my computer to...
I think it was an interesting one that you've chosen here, because you've obviously chosen, you know, to talk about black and white. And that's something that is not as simple as people might think. It's, you know, things aren't as simple as color and black and white.
That's right.
There's many different types of black and white, and there's
exactly
many things you have to take into consideration.
That's it. I mean, I really enjoy printing black and white. Like I do a lot of my own printing now, and it just looks so beautiful. I've been using a cotton rag. It's very thick paper, like a metallic, and it's just, yeah, it's beautiful. But I don't think I'm going to be able to share my screen here. It's just not giving me those options anymore. So
yeah, might be a bit hard to figure out.
That's okay. But
I'll just flick through just between the color and
yeah, chuck yours back up. Is yours back up there?
Yeah.
Not yet. It is? Yeah. Okay. So this particular image is, so the way it works is, this image here I had strobes on, so I don't normally shoot with strobes, but I wanted to really accentuate the turtle's shell and to cast as much light on there as possible. I generally just use natural light to get my photos underwater. But using the strobes in really clear water, you can get some great results. So obviously I've captured the image in color. And now what you do is when you open an image, and I always shoot in raw, you can go and click the black and white box. Now to achieve this image here, where it's super contrasty, where the water goes really black, all you have to do is just drag the blue color, blue luminance, or the blue, blue luminance right down. And then that will create that extra contrast there in the blues. And that makes that turtle really stand out. And it's something that I've been doing a lot of lately. And I've got a gallery here in Byron Bay, and I love having those images up there. And they really, especially if I have like a theme going, they look beautiful. Yeah, it's very simple to do.
And what do you think it is about black and white? You know, when do you make that decision that this photo works?
Yeah, it's tough. I think it's when there's a lot of like my photograph of Mingaloo. He's a white whale, and he's in this deep blue sea, and he just, you know, when I make it black and white, he really stands out. I think it's anything that sort of is really prominent for me. I'm not so much into that sort of landscape black and white look. I'm more about the portraiture or the symmetry of my images. That's when it really talks to me in black and white. It has to be quite profound. Like the image has to have not much negative space. It has to have, you know, be quite dominant with my subject. And it's also texture as well. Like, you know, the shell of the turtle, you know, there's a lot of color. And when I make it black and white, there's a lot of features on there that make it interesting.
I mean, when I look at this photo, it certainly seems more realistic for someone like me to achieve, who doesn't really swim. I'm not a strong swimmer at all. So when I see like your whale pictures, I'm like, that's so amazing. And I just know I'm probably not going to be able to do that. When I see this, I'm like, oh, maybe.
it's not hard. Like it's quite easy to do.
What's the bare minimum? What do you need to get started to take underwater photography? Gear wise, do you need at bare minimum?
I mean, a lot of my students, some of my students, they come to Tonga, say to swim the humpback whales with me, and they go, is a GoPro all right? And it's fine. You know, if they're not really into investing much money into a camera because they don't know whether they want to stick with that sort of hobby or not, and they're just there for the experience, and a GoPro is fine. You can get good results out of that little camera. But if you're looking at sort of, you know, moving into that sort of amateur pro, you know, professional range, then you're going to have to look at a digital SLR, where, because underwater you do need wider lenses. You know, this particular image was taken the 16-35 at 16mm, and you do need that sort of wide feature underwater, because a lot of the time you don't have crystal clear water, and the wider the lens is, the clearer the water will look, because you're not shooting through so much water, because when you're wider, the subject has to be closer anyway to fill the frame. So, you know, I think if you want to really start out, then by all means sort of go and try and find a local photography workshop, underwater photography workshop, if possible, like your local dive shop. Sometimes they run them. And also maybe just think about hiring a camera setup in a water house. And it's, you know, in most capital cities in Australia, you can go in there and hire an Aquatech water housing. You know, you can Sony A6500 or A7 Mark III, or, you know, any Canons or Nikon. So it's quite accessible. And I'd suggest doing that, like, instead of going out there and spending, you know, $3,000 or $4,000 on a setup before you even know that's what you want to do. Because it is challenging. Like, there's lots of elements to underwater photography that sort of partake in taking the photo, and that's feeling comfortable in the water, understanding the animals you're photographing, and also learning to hold your breath underwater for a large amount of times, because that's a really good way of getting nice intimate photos with animals, is to hold your breath underwater and not scuba, because they get a little
I think this comes back to what we were talking about before, like what you were saying actually, you know, about being comfortable with your camera and learning all the manual settings, just so when you are in a dynamic environment, then you know what to do. And I relate this because I, for the first time ever, I tried doing underwater photography with some housing, Aquatech housing, about 6 months ago in the Maldives, because we needed some underwater shots. And I thought, okay, I'm finally just going to try. I know I'm not going to be very good at it. Surprisingly, it was like easy enough to kind of click around and do things.
Yeah.
But just holding your breath and like, diving down, like,
yeah,
it was really embarrassing, because the friend that I was shooting was more of a swimmer, so she would dive really deep down and float around, and I'd go down and like take like two photos and then start going back up again. I'm sorry, I just can't do it. I don't know, but you know, and I think it ties in, because you know, you can't just jump straight into things like that and expect to be really good. You know, you've got to build up the foundations of swimming first, and then, you know, once you have all these skills, once you're down there, you your options are so much more than like what they are.
And you know, like, say for turtles, for instance, you understand their behaviors, and you understand that you can't swim at them. If you swim at them, then you're a predator. So you have to sort of stand, like, just be very still and let them come to you. And obviously a turtle breathes. So try and place yourself, like in that particular photo, the actual turtle's coming up to breathe. So I'm on top of it. So I've just waited there and got the photo. And same with whales. You have to understand their behavior and do not swim at whales. They'll swim away and, you know, you won't even get a photo. So there's lots of elements there, but it's persistence and also listening to other people that, you know, either marine biologists or, you know, they can give you advice on animal behavior.
You just reminded me of another incident that happened on this thing. I would love to have some footage of what I look like trying to get these photos. I don't really, you know how to snorkel or anything either. So I didn't have my mask on properly, I assume, because it just really started fogging up for most of the thing. And I like...
Oh, you gotta spit in it.
You gotta spit in it.
I did that. There was other stuff going on and like water was coming in as well. It was just like a big mess. And I was like, at some point I just stopped trying to fix it because I thought like, this is stupid, whatever. So I was swimming around. And then my friend, like I was just kind of like, I could vaguely see the shape of my friend. So I was following her and just blindly clicking. And then once we like finished, she was like, wow, that was incredible. And I was like, what do you mean? She's like, we were swimming with a turtle the whole time. I was like, ah, oh, I didn't even know. I couldn't even see. I was just like, so, you know, I could have had a shot like this, you know, if I'd prepared better, but unfortunately didn't get it.
Or practiced.
All right. Well, back to me before we head to Demas for one last photo, but I chose this one. There's quite a bit of lag happening. Can you guys see it on the screen yet?
Not yet.
What is going on? It's like lagging more and more as we go along.
Oh, there we go.
Okay. So, you know, a lot of Aurora photos I had to choose from for this. A lot of people ask about photographing the Northern Lights, so I thought, throw one in. Which one do I pick? I thought this one because it has, for me, it's probably like you guys were saying, it's one of those life experiences that you just always remember. It's not necessarily about the photo. It's about the circumstances and situation, you know, to get there. And this was a moment that, you know, I just really felt like I was, you know, doing what I was supposed to be doing and living the life that I wanted to be living, you know, and that doesn't come very often, these feelings. But this was, you know, as classic shooting winter in Iceland, it was maybe 2 or 3 a.m. I was driving by myself. I think this was after a week-long workshop that I ran, and I always love having a few days to myself afterwards just to take the car out and just be on my own, and it's a different feeling. And I remember this one being about 2 or 3 a.m. driving down these roads, and I see this like slow green aurora beam, you know, moving across the sky, and I was looking out the window driving at the same time, just like, what do I do? I need to find the perfect spot for this, you know, because I wanted a spot that was open, you know, no houses or anything in the way. Came across this hill, and I was like, oh my god, it's perfect, it's gonna move across the hill. But it was moving kind of quickly, and it was a race to try and get where I wanted in time. You know, the camera was actually quite a fair way away from where the top of the hill is. So I parked the car on the side of the road, got bogged straight away. I tried to get out, I couldn't, and I was like, whatever, sort this out later. I jumped out the car, pretty sure I left it unlocked, like sprinting through the snow with my tripod and camera. The wind was howling, and I had just seen this movie called The Conjuring. I don't know if you guys have seen it, but there's these scenes where like dead ghosts are like hanging in trees with windy haunted sounds around. Anyway, that was what was flashing through my mind. I was like, this is so scary, I'm all alone in the wilderness, but I'll keep going. And I remember like running and falling over, I was before tripping in the snow, and I was just laughing to myself because it was just so funny and no one else could even witness this. Put the camera down. I had to run around the back of the hill because I didn't want to get my footsteps in the shot. And finally, I like got to the top, had my remote control, just stood there like panting, be like, no, gotta stay still. It's like a long shutter. And I got there just in time, like just in time. You can see like any, you know, 30 seconds later, the green would have passed my body. Anyway, that's the story behind that. And I just like, it's those kind of moments that that you live for, really, when you take on this kind of lifestyle and career. You know, clicking the photo is just one little part of it, but everything else around it. And, you know, I wouldn't have been running and laughing through the snow at 3 a.m. in Iceland if it wasn't to take a photo. So the end product is what has, you know, created all the experiences for it. And that's what I love about photography. It's not actually the photo, the clicking the shutter part. That bit's fun. But nearly every amazing experience I've had over the past 8 or 9 years has been because I was trying to take a photo. And it doesn't matter if the photo worked or not. It would still be like such a funny memory to have. And I want to show the next slide. I just want to touch on collaboration again, because I think that's like super important for young artists in particular. Always be looking to collaborate and network. And when you do, your skills just like grow and go in this different direction that you wouldn't have thought possible. If you're just in isolation creating your art, it's great for, you know, however long you do. But when you work with other artists, this synergy happens, and then just crazy stuff happens that you couldn't think of yourself in your own brain. And this is an example here. You know, I one of my exhibitions a couple of years ago is with an artist called Prez Juan. And I was showing him his photos, and we came up with this idea of the Northern Lights being the gateway to the cat overlord universe. And, you know, something as simple as this photo that I took has now taken on this new life. And I think that's what's super cool when you combine, you know, your artistic pursuits together. You don't know what you're going to come out with. Someone did ask before, they wanted to know about Aurora photos more because of what camera settings do you have to take them. Answer is, it can be different every time because it depends on, it's all about light, right? So it depends on how strong the light is. It depends on how fast it's moving across the sky. But in general, it's really easy to take Aurora photos. Really, really easy. I reckon I would be able to do it without even looking at doing, like, without a test shot now. It's all about just having like a long enough shutter so that the light soak in, having a high ISO so you can pick up the stars, and chucking it on a tripod, leaving it wide open. Like, that part is all easy. So, you know, it might seem like these kind of photos are super crazy, but it's more the hard bit is like putting yourself in that situation, taking a risk to go to Iceland and hire a car and drive around by yourself. That's the hard bit. Taking the photo, easy. It's all about getting yourself into these situations. Okay, this is going to be a little experiment because I think I want Demas to screen share, but we have maybe just proven it won't work. Bear with us, because I'm going to turn off mine and see if that allows you. Whoops, that's not even the one we're talking about. Ignore that, everybody. I don't know how to turn it off. Okay.
So I'll try.
Give it a shot. Let's see. It might work. It might not.
Is that working?
Ah.
Yep. Well, it's just,
okay. Sorry, Craig. That was actually quite simple.
Oh my God. You're kidding.
So this image here is actually a little bit of an animation. So there's this house in Kyoto in Japan called the Face House, which is this guy here. It's a real place. And I've seen a lot of photos of it during the day. And I was on a job for Japan Tourism towards the end of last year. And we had a free night to ourselves, like me and my friend who was my assistant at the time. And we're like, let's try see the Face House. Maybe it's lit up. Maybe it's cool because we've never seen a night shot of it before. So we're like, let's give it a go. We went there and it actually looked like this. So it was like completely black. And I was like, oh no, our idea didn't work because we wanted to get like a cool, like, you know, the eyes are popping and like the mouth is like, we wanted like this light lit up house that looked like a face. So we went there and it wasn't like this, but we bought our own light. So we took a shot This is, let me just turn off the eyes. So this is one shot we took as well, with just a with a light behind my friend, and it's like shining, and it's like the shadows going through his legs. And I thought it was pretty cool, but then I'm like, I think I can Photoshop the eyes as well, so that the building actually comes to life. So I made like a little animation of it and photoshopped the eyes as well, and it kind of just like lights up if you just turn it on and off. And like if you once you add a bit of sound and like a light switch sound, like a little bit of a atmospheric noise, it kind of has that feeling of like a cool Japanese street, like fantasy feel, but it's like, it's a real place, and it's pretty crazy that you're there seeing it. And we just had a bunch of fun that night, just like trying to get this animation or this shot to work out. But yeah, it's just like, we just had a free night, and we just decided, instead of just like staying in our hotel rooms doing nothing, just like, let's just go explore Kyoto and see what we can get. And then this is what we got that night. Just super fun.
I think that's a cool example of, you know, just imagination and problem solving. You know, you think of an idea, and this is probably the part that people get stuck at. They'll be like, wow, wouldn't it be great if, you know, the eyes are lighting up and the mouth lighting up, but then they don't know how to go to that next step. But it's actually quite simple if you just break it all down. It's like, well, okay, I want some light in the mouth. Let's go grab a light and just chuck it in the mouth, you know? And well, how are we going to get the eyes to light up? We can't really do that in real life. Maybe we can do that in Photoshop.
The eyes is literally just a white circle. Like you just color in a white circle on top of that, and then you just add a glow, and it's just like pretty much it. That's it. Like it's pretty simple when you think of it, but like when you look at it, it looks really complicated.
I think it's a good lesson. Yeah. Because often, you know, you'll have things won't be exactly how you want them.
Exactly.
And it's not a reason to just not do it. It's a reason to think of ways that you could actually make it happen. And I think that's when I talk to photographers, I talk a lot about this with Benjamin Hardman, if everybody knows who he is. He's a photographer in Iceland. He's actually from Perth and did a Propel talk with me last year. We talk a lot about that, our most important skills being resourcefulness, not actually anything else. It's just because we often just go on road trips around the perimeter of Iceland and stuff goes wrong every couple hours. And it's really quite funny. But we just love it because it just, each time something happens, it's an opportunity to get scrappy and work out how to fix it. It's like, shit, I forgot this, or my tripod broke, you know, and you just have to like build tripods out of rocks, or like or you forgot a lens. You know, you have to do all these like, just like funny things to make things happen. And that's, I think that, you know, can be the difference between a really good photographer and one who isn't so sure on their feet, because as we've all said, when you go on a shoot, it's not going to be the perfect conditions ever, really. Yeah. And it's all about, okay, this problem has popped up. What are you going to do about it? And if you've had the experience and you've done it, this kind of stuff a million times, you'll be able to work out really quickly, oh, okay, maybe I need to do this and that will fix the problem.
Yeah.
Whereas some people with less experience, that will take a lot longer to come to that solution. And that you know, that can be a real kind of what can distinguish you from other photographers.
Yeah, I think so too. Definitely.
All right. We've got, probably got about 15 minutes left. So I have some questions that were people sent in earlier. Maybe we could quickly
should I stop sharing.
Yeah. Oh, here we go. We've got big pictures now. Let's just answer some questions through like this. I think this would be good. So this has come in the actual chat, and this is one we can answer quickly. What computer/laptop hardware do you all use for photo editing? I'll start. I just use a MacBook Pro. I don't even know which one. I got it maybe 3 years ago. Maxed out the settings. For me, you know, I do quite a bit of video editing, so processing power is important, but, not, you know, if there's anything crazy editing that needs to happen, I'll probably get somebody else to do it who knows how to do it. So my computer's optimized for travel. You know, I don't want a huge computer to like lug around if I'm on the road all the time. Michelle, what have you got?
Yeah, MacBook Pro as well. Just using Lightroom mostly, and yeah, a bit of Photoshop as well. So They're my tools.
Craig?
Yeah, MacBook Pro, Photoshop, and I sort of go through my images on Bridge. Bridge is for me is a really good cataloging to open it straight up into Photoshop. It's a hard one because I've been through so many computers. I'm sort of stuck on Apple because I'm comfortable with it. The amount of times that I've been using a MacBook Pro and the graphic card goes on them, and I've had that a lot because I work them really hard because I do a lot of video as well. And I love the system. I love the Apple system, but yeah, I've had a lot fail on me.
Demas, what do you got?
I'm the odd one out. I use a PC, no, like a laptop.
You would be an Android, a Microsoft guy.
I want a Samsung phone. I use a Razer Blade 15. So it's kind of like a gaming laptop, but it's like a gaming laptop for creatives, I guess. And I use a lot of Lightroom, Photoshop, and Premiere because I've been trying to make lots of YouTube videos lately.
So it seems like, looks like, you know, it doesn't matter what you use. I think most, computers these days will be able to process, you know, most of the things that you're doing. So I never worry too much about the laptop side of things. Or to be honest, the camera side of things, you know, it's all about the imagination and a lot of equipment you can get. Just tech in general, it's kind of does the same thing and doesn't matter too much. Okay. Was there a defining moment for you in your career? This is from Lily. Oh, tough one. I'll try to think of one quickly. I don't know about defining moment, but it's kind of similar. I have a photo that was kind of similar to the one that you took of Rule. Like, it's of Passenger from behind, crowd waving their arms around in the air at the O2 Arena in Dublin. He was supporting Ed Sheeran, so it was a huge crowd. And the reason this sticks out to me is because I had been working with a Passenger, his real name is Mike, for, you know, six years or so before that moment. And it was not glamorous at the beginning, I could tell you that. We were like staying in like hostels around Australia, sharing beds, actually in the Gold Coast. I can't remember the name, but that was like the lowest moment because the accommodation booked for us was like a Byron Bay backpackers. And we walked into the room, there's four of us. And the accommodation we had was like a single bunk bed for four people. And we just looked at each other like, no, we just like, this, what is this? And we just walked out and we just left. So, you know, being through all these experiences of struggle and watching this artist, you know, with really great music, but doing everything he could and not getting the recognition and success that he should have been getting. It was really quite a tough time for him and for me to watch it as well. I was like, man, what do we got to do? You know, we'll keep trucking on. And then, you know, fast forward to this concert. This was after his song Let Her Go had gone like massive, and suddenly people were singing the words to him. And I remember just being behind him on the stage, so much love coming from the crowd. And I'm just standing behind him taking these photos. I was like crying at the same time. And I was like, oh, you've made it, man. You've made it. What are we doing here? So that was a special moment for me. It kind of just, you know, showed me, I guess, taught me the lesson that, you know, the hard work will pay off. You know, if you do everything the right way, you know, you put in the hard work, you treat everybody nice, and you just keep at it. It's not like eventually it will come. The success will come. You'd be extremely unlucky for it not to come if you put in like years of hard work and you're treating everybody nice. And I stress that because it is about like treating people well and hard work. And I'd say talent comes third. You know, you don't have to be the best at anything to have a successful career. It's about all the other stuff. You could be, I often have to hire people for projects and hire photographers. And, you know, when I'm looking at people, I think, you know, do I want the very best photographer on this list, but they're a bit douchey and I don't want to be around them. Or do I want the second or third best photographer on this list, but they're just really cool and I like hanging out with them? Like, well, I'm going to pick them, obviously, because I don't need, whoever needs the best photograph in the world, you just need someone to get the job done and feel the brief, but you want to have a good time doing it. So anyway, that was a really long answer. Does anybody else have a defining moment that can be answered in a shorter period?
Yeah, I've got two pretty big defining moments. I think when I released my first book, which was called Rise, which is a photo documentary into hip hop in Australia. It was a self-published book that came out in 2014. So I think that was really big, like career defining moment, and really, I guess, established myself in the music industry. And the second one would be when the documentary, Her Sound, Her Story, was released along with the portrait series, which was like 88 portraits. That came out in 2018. Both those projects are in the National Sound and Film Archive. So they've both been really big portrait projects that, yeah, I'm really proud of, and I think I've kind of cemented myself in the music industry.
Craig.
Two big ones, you know, when I photographed Migaloo, that was a pretty special moment. It was the first time he'd been photographed underwater, and it was the same time, very similar time when I was opening my bio and gallery. So it was sort of, yeah, made it a really good launch to have Migaloo printed really big and had a lot of press behind it, which was nice. And that moment there was, you know, absolutely magical. Like, it's a dream of any underwater photographer to photograph the whale. The other one was only 2 months ago. I got asked to do a job here in Australia, and it was in with Disney and National Geographic, and yeah, and then that sort of, I gave them the photos from the first job, and I wasn't supposed to go, but then they liked my photos so much, went to Norway with them in February, and then got a call from their head office in America wanting me to do more with Nat Geo. So that was, for me, it was only a couple of months ago. It was a really defining moment in my career, and it's something that I've always dreamt of and also worked towards very fresh.
Me, I guess.
Yeah.
My moment, I guess, would be because I didn't expect to be a photographer. Like, I just was doing it for fun as a hobby. I think my moment was when like a big brand emailed me for the first time. Like, Adidas or Nike emailed me for the first time, just like 2 years into me like taking photos just for fun. And to be able to, like, just because of that through social media and being able to land jobs to shoot for a massive brand like that was like so mind-boggling at the time. I was like, I can't believe these guys want to work with me. And then I guess it's just like through time you build up, you keep working with different people and you're just like, I can't believe I'm working with these guys. And you just keep going and going and going. But yeah, I'm just still like taking it one day at a time. I just became a freelancer today. So maybe today's my career defining moment. I don't know.
Yeah, that deserves a round of applause. Well done. Hey, this is an interesting one from Elliot. And maybe Michelle can answer this. At what age can you start working for people as a photographer?
Oh, that's I didn't start shooting until I was 31. So, and I don't know if there is an age. I think I definitely have proven that it doesn't, you know, it's a lot of people do start when they're really young, especially in music photography as well. So I think the right answer to that question is usually when people approach you to work for them, that's when you can work for them, I think. So you can make that decision when people are approaching you to pay you.
Even before that, even before getting paid, I think I'm not sure exactly what the question is asking, to be honest, but I imagine that it's quite a young person, maybe looking at photographers, you know, doing cool jobs and thinking, you know, when can I start trying, you know, because it seems like it's an adult thing to do, but it's totally not. You can start taking photos right now, you know, with your phone or like.
Yeah, totally. And I mean, on the flip side of that too, like some people think they're too old to start things as well. So it's like, I just don't really believe there's any age barriers. Just if you can, you know, if you have a passion for it, you know, just follow it because, you know, people, you've heard all the people on the panel today, like there's a real love for what we do and we do lead really incredible lives, but it's because we have a genuine passion for it. So yeah
there's no age limit. I mean anybody at any age can. Okay, I gotta revise this because I was going to say, you know, anyone could just message anyone on Instagram and say you want to take photos, but maybe don't be doing that if you're under 18. I don't know, there's some safety stuff here.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
In general, if you, there's another artist, you know, or there's another photographer, or there's someone doing something cool and you think, wow, you know, this, it'd be cool to take photos of that person. You can, you don't have to wait for anything. You can, you can just ask them, you know.
Can ask the question. Sure. Yep. Absolutely.
Okay, a couple more minutes. Any last questions? Just shooting through the Q&A. I'm just going through a couple that were sent in earlier. How about... Why is photography the medium you work with, from Patrick? For me, that's an interesting one because my first passion was actually music. And I probably, you know, if I could choose whether I was a successful musician or a photographer, I'd probably choose musician, to be honest. But photographer is that's my medium because that allows me to express myself in the most authentic way. You know, I love playing music and I loved playing on stage. It was like the best time ever, but you know, I'm not a songwriter and it's just something fun. But photography, I can actually communicate. I can actually come up with ideas and execute them and express myself that way. It just happens that's the best form for me. Anyone else have an answer for that? Why photography?
I think it's the same, right? Like it's a way of expression and how you express yourself. I see it as like a way to see the world and like seeing it differently for me. Like how do I see something that everyone sees every day, but how do I capture that differently? It's like sort of a challenge for me as well. So yeah, that's why I choose photography. I'm leaning like a little bit more towards like animations and videos and that kind of stuff now. And like, but it's all there. Like it's all like being creative and trying to do stuff and just, yeah.
For me, I have a real passion for still images, and it's the reason like I don't really gravitate towards video, like I don't enjoy it as much, but there's something in freezing a moment of time that will never be again that I have a real passion for, and especially when it comes to like live music photography and being able to share one image that like encapsulates the feeling of an entire event, that if you weren't at that event you could actually feel what that feels like, I guess. So that's where my passion comes from.
I just want to share the experience that I had with others and it sort of amplifies my experience then by doing so, and I try and capture it in a way that's creative and that just keeps the fire burning. You know, so I think my both passions is for me is traveling and photography, and they sort of mix together and create something nice.
Awesome. I just want to end with one last question and then we can wrap it up. I would like to know just very briefly from everybody, what can you give what's your one piece of advice to a young artist starting out now, start of their career, kind of just still finding their feet? Is there anything that you live by now that, you know, you wish you had, you know, known back in the day?
The one that I always tell people who ask me this question all the time is just like shoot as much as you can, like shoot every single day, shoot in like different circumstances, put a camera in all of your friends' faces, like just practice under every single circumstance, because there'll be a situation in the future where hopefully you're hired for a job and maybe you only have 5 minutes to get the shot, but all of that practice that you had in random situations, like all the skills that you get in those early years are really going to help you, I think, in the future. So, yeah, that's my advice.
Yeah, I mean, I can, like what Michelle was saying, I think that practice part of it's really important, and it's that practice that allows you to get into these creative flow states and sort of get in those zones that are creative. I think without practice, you it's very difficult to jump inside those creative patterns. And also, the more you shoot, the you get, sometimes if you shoot a subject a lot, you get quite bored of it. So you're always trying to change it and make it a bit more interesting. I think that's, and then that's when you start to find that you're doing something unique and creative and capturing images that haven't been seen before. Yeah.
I think for me, it's all about curiosity and like asking yourself the question, like, how can I make things better? How can I get better at this? How can I get better at that? So if you see something like on the internet that you think is cool, that you want to emulate, then you can go out and try to emulate it, but you always try to have to think, how can I make it my own? How can I make it better than this other person that I've been inspired by? So yeah, always try to take it to another level is my advice.
Awesome. And I just want to end it with my piece of advice, which is just collaborate with as many people as you can. You know, show up to things like this, you know, where there's a, you know, build a community, because the people that you work with now and the people you reach out to, you know, they will help you through your career. They'll be the people that you ask for advice. They'll ask you for advice. They're the ones you'll, you know, ring when you have an emergency and you need a backup photographer or a new lens or something. Like, start building those connections now. You know, it's not something like we were talking about before, you know, like you grow together with these people. And that's what's happened with me. You know, I started out in the music industry and then I started out as a music photographer as well. And those people that I like collaborated with back then are all my friends now. And they're all like massive artists now. But back in the day, they were just people playing local shows and I would message them like, I message like Kate Miller-Heidke, Ballpark Music, Matt Corby, all those guys are doing so well now. You know, all our friendship started because I sent a message on probably MySpace or probably like or Facebook or something saying, hey, I saw you're in town. Do you want to go take some photos just before you show? You know, that's how it starts. And then those friendships grow, those networks grow and you grow together. And it's really wonderful when you look around at the people that you like surround yourself with and you're like, oh, wow, we all started down the bottom. Now we're here. All right, I should probably end it on that. Thank you to Propel. That was a really cool session. I think if you missed the start of it, it should all be on Facebook, maybe. If you have any questions for any of these photographers, it's very easy to find them on Instagram. Just search their names.
Yep.
There's a few questions that we didn't get to. I'll try to get to them privately if there's anyone that has anything. But just reach out. Everybody's very friendly. And thanks for watching. Thank you, Propel.
Thanks, Propel. Thanks, Jarrad. Love you guys. Thanks, Michelle. Thanks,
see you guys.
See you later. Yeah.
Bye.